I'm here in my own personal capacity. Internet governance is a fascinating subject. It's worth making a distinction between governance of the internet, which is essentially administration of the internet, its functions, the management of its addressing structures, the management of the routing, et cetera, with governance on the internet, which is really the transfer of all the things that society has been doing for the last 5,000 years onto an internet base, and the manner in which it is transferred, and the way in which we govern those things, the way in which we make sure that they can, the way in which we do it contributes to society rather than distracts from it or weakens it. So the title of this session, Assessing the Legitimacy of Structures and Processes, I think probably should be extended to say assessing also the effectiveness of how we use the internet and the structures and processes that we define to make sure that that happens. So the organizers of the session have asked that we have vigorous audience participation, and there's nothing like internet governance as a subject to guarantee it, because it's one of these subjects where the quote, I don't remember where I got it from, the quote is, everything has been said, but not everybody has said it. And here we are, and there's everybody is in this room, and everybody can say it. So I'd like to try the following timing for the for the session. We have to break a few minutes before 4:30 because our keynote speaker will be starting his presentation at 4:30 downstairs. We have six speakers, and I'm going to allocate 5 to 6 minutes for them initially to go through, and I'll give you their instructions in a minute, and then audience participation, and depending on how many people want to say something, let's start with a deadline of something like 90 seconds apiece. And if nobody wants to say anything, then you can go further and expound your favorite dimension in internet governance. So I've structured this as essentially a risk analysis. We all know that the internet is great. We all know that internet governance matters a lot. We all have gone through in the last, depending on how you count, 6 months, 12 months, 2 years, a major transition in governance of the internet because of the restructuring of ICANN. It's probably not worth playing that back very much. So as a risk analysis, I've asked the panelists to address the following question. What is the worst thing that can happen in internet governance? What's the worst faux pas, the worst policy that can happen in internet governance? And then, why is it the worst thing? What are the results? If it really happens, what's the real danger to the internet itself? Do we know how to fix it? Who is responsible for fixing it? Individuals, organizations, not who caused it, but who's responsible. If we really want to fix it, who are the main actors who are going to be able to do it? Do we know how to do it? And what's your real world estimate about whether you will succeed or not? So each panelist gets 6 minutes, and to describe the nightmare of internet governance, not done well, and then we can turn the floor over to those of you who want to participate. I assume we have a roving mic. I'd like to have the panelists make their presentations in the order in your schedule, and we start with Miriam Sapiro, Ambassador Sapiro, partner and head of Washington, D.C. office, Finsbury.
Very much, George. Is this on? Yeah. Can everybody hear me? Okay, great. I wanted to sort of give an overview by talking about what disruptions and uncertainty that we're facing today, particularly these shifting notions of sovereignty, might mean for the multi-stakeholder model of internet governance. Donald Trump, now President Trump, has inherited a U.S. economy with sustained growth, nearly full employment, but with a deeply divided electorate, and I mean that both economically and politically. He wants to radically transform decades of foreign and domestic policy with a new America First policy in some ways that worry a number of people in the U.S. and also overseas. I was in Davos last week and was a little surprised to find a lot of optimism from CEOs including CEOs of some of the largest companies that are here at the conference. And let me just say that I hope that they will be right. But at the moment, I see potential for a significant disruption, both in the U.S. and in Europe and elsewhere potentially. And I know that personally in a sense because we've been working with clients who are very worried. As the first president to make aggressive and seemingly unfiltered use of Twitter as a political weapon, Trump has routinely attacked manufacturers, other companies, accusing them of exporting jobs and other things. In fact, I brought with me, I'm sorry I was a few minutes late, but one reason is we wanted to bring copies in case anyone's interested of a short piece we did for clients on how to deal with Trump's tweets in a both a proactive and a reactive way. And also, there are copies in the back if you're interested on kind of the overview of what's coming on trade, investment, immigration, as well as healthcare, energy, a number of issues that I think some of you are interested in, besides internet governance. What's challenging is that those that are trying to stay above the political fray are still finding themselves drawn in with, you know, often little notice or provocation. And the shift that we're seeing in the U.S. is, of course, not unique. We're seeing populist nationalist movements taking root in the U.K. We obviously had the Brexit decision 7 months ago. France also, and Germany, both with very important elections coming up, Austria, Hungary, and other countries as well. This anger is leading to more and more support for movements that call for greater national sovereignty, which is a big change from the post-World War II era that most of us are more familiar with. For decades, countries have willingly ceded some degree of sovereignty to an international organization like the UN Security Council, like the WTO, like the EU. In fact, every time a country negotiates and cedes to a treaty, in some sense, are giving up some degree of sovereignty, but also they can typically withdraw from such obligations, so it's not irreversible. But I think the interesting question for this panel is, what are the implications of the shift towards greater national sovereignty for companies and organizations and communities that are highly dependent on a stable, secure, interoperable, and resilient internet? What does it mean specifically for internet governance and for the multi-stakeholder model? I think it means we're going to have to fight even harder to explain and to preserve the multi-stakeholder model. We saw a lot of support and validation for this model in the process that led to the completion of ICANN's transformation from oversight by the Department of Commerce to a genuine multi-stakeholder model. And I know there are many here that played a role, but I want to recognize especially Steve DelBianco and Jonathan Zuck for all of the many hours they put into making that happen in the right way. The model is not without its flaws and its challenges, but it's sort of like democracy. It's far better than the alternatives. So this also means we're going to have to articulate and defend key principles that help us preserve a free and open internet and advance freedoms like freedom of expression, freedom of association, in which governments play a supporting role in keeping the internet free and open, but not a demanding role and not a deciding role, not a determining role, but letting the private sector and the technical community continue to flourish. It also means that we have to continue to combat efforts that risk fragmentation, that risk balkanization. In this context, trade agreements, even though trade has become a toxic word in the US and in Europe, they can be helpful in this regard because these obligations can help secure and preserve the ability to transfer data and to preserve other forms of communication across borders. So let me close with just mentioning four specific aspects of that cross-border data flow that I think are going to be really important to try to preserve in the next few months and years. Number one would be to preserve the cross-border data flows that U.S. and global companies are so dependent on, consistent, of course, with legitimate privacy concerns. Two is to protect consumers when they use the internet. This used to mean protecting them from fraudulent scams, you know, cousins of cousins in Nigeria, not to pick on Nigeria, but that, I think I got Nigerian emails more than any other, or protecting them from fake or unsafe goods. But now it may even mean protecting them or making them aware of what we have come to call fake news and alternative facts. Three is prevent localization barriers, meaning a country shouldn't be able to demand that someone who wants to be there create a local cloud or local data center. And last, we shouldn't be banning forced tech transfers when companies or organizations want to establish a presence overseas. You should not have to share your secrets to be able to do business or to communicate. So in conclusion, I think we're clearly experiencing a time of rapid change and watching coalitions change and shift before our very eyes. Uncertainty seems to be becoming the new normal. But notwithstanding growing efforts to exercise more, quote, national sovereignty, we have tools at our disposal to help defend the multi-stakeholder model and preserve a thriving, dynamic, open internet for all. So let's use them.
Thank you. So if we don't do that, we end up with fragmentation. We end up with an attack on the multi-stakeholder model and isolationism. Milton?
So George asked us to identify the major issue or problem in internet governance, one that could go so far as to determine the success or failure of much of the entire internet as we know it.
Right.
So I believe that cybersecurity is the main problem in internet governance. And depending on how we handle it, this could undermine the success of the entire internet. Now, don't get me wrong, I'm not a cybersecurity alarmist. I do not believe we are imminently threatened with a digital Pearl Harbor. I do not believe that Russian influence operations are weaponizing our media. I do not believe that I should store canned beans in my basement after reading Ted Koppel's book about the energy grid. That's not what I mean at all. What I'm worried about is how national governments react to cybersecurity, and I'm more worried about that than I am about everyday cybersecurity threats themselves. The biggest threat of cybersecurity is that it becomes an excuse to nationalize and militarize and thus destroy the open internet. An exaggerated and poorly thought out reaction to cyber threats is pushing internet governance away from its reliance on distributed non-state actor-based governance mechanisms and towards centralized, state-controlled, and jurisdictionally fragmented approaches to internet governance. And the oddest thing is, we don't even think of this as internet governance because we call it cybersecurity. So we need to reconceive of cybersecurity as an internet governance issue, if not the central internet governance issue of our times. ICANN is so 1999. Too many people, including this conference, tend to put cybersecurity and internet governance into separate boxes and talk about them separately, look to different institutions and methods for solving the problems, and I think this is really a mistake. Information security and network security are fundamental to how we connect to the internet protocols, to how we use the data or services available, how things are connected to the internet. So much of what we do or cannot do online is now shaped by authentication, passwords, detection and blocking of malware, encryption, and other methods of protecting our security. So to say that cybersecurity and internet governance are not fundamentally the same domain is to me very strange. These are all fundamentally transnational governance problems, just as the administration of the domain name system and IP addressing system were 20 years ago. And in the case of ICANN, it led to institutional innovations in the form of these non-state actor-led institutions. So why are we now reverting to national, territorially fragmented approaches to solve cybersecurity problems? I think as we develop new solutions to cybersecurity, we have to ask ourselves some fundamental questions. First, who is empowered by our approaches to cybersecurity problems? Is it only the state? Is it only the military? Or are we also trying to empower end users at the edges? Second, are our approaches to these issues helping to sustain global connectivity, or do they mirror the territorial fragmentation of state sovereignty? Third, are the institutional venues we use to attack cybersecurity problems open and multi-stakeholder, or are they closed and state-centric? In sum, we need to relink the internet governance and cybersecurity discussions. Thank you.
So what's your prognosis? Are we going to be able to do it or not?
Well, I'm not a determinist. The reason I say things is that I believe that you can actually shape the outcome. So I don't know what the outcome will be. I think that we are in a historical period where the nationalists definitely have the upper hand, or at least the trend is in their direction. And I think this needs to be countered at intellectual levels, at and at the sort of political level as well.
Thank you. John Knoyer.
So I think Milton may think my comments strange, if I understood his comments the way I thought I did. You know, George, I think you start us off in a very good place talking about internet governance versus governance on the internet. And I think keeping them separate and not conflating them is the best way to ensure the success of the IANA transition and the technical issues that we worked so hard to conclude. The internet governance, as we have come to think about it in terms of the domain name system and the technical coordination of IP addresses and the development of IP protocols, are issues that are inherently and specifically technical in nature, and they are inherently and specifically global in nature. The internet works or it does not. The technical coordination is singular or it is not. The concepts of governance on the internet raises issues that are inherently non-technical in nature, or at least not necessarily technical in nature. To take a simple example in terms of the openness of the internet and the protection of free speech on the internet, one would assume that our most like-minded partners in international policy on things like free speech and the internet would be our European colleagues. But concepts of free speech in Europe and the United States don't necessarily always line up. There are categories of speech in Europe, for example, that might be ugly and hateful. You know, denial of the Holocaust is not permissible speech. It would be considered ugly speech, but very much protected here in the United States. And so if we're going to the danger in conflating, overly conflating policy issues that do have sovereignty characteristics with the internet governance structures that are specifically designed for this narrow technical operation of the core infrastructure, I think invites the danger of proponents of particular policies want to invite themselves into the technical discussion as a vehicle for their preferred outcomes. And this is the thing that has always been the big risk with increased government oversight into these technical issues. So while I agree the importance of these things, cyber and other, are going to be places where the multi-stakeholder model may be very wholesome in trying to narrow disagreements between sovereigns, I don't necessarily think they should take place in the same vehicle. And I think we ought to be very careful to make sure that the technical issues are isolated from these other policy and sovereignty connected issues. And I think that is going to be the challenge for the internet community and for ICANN in particular. Now that the Department of Commerce has stepped away from whatever oversight role it had, and as the one-time embodiment of that oversight vehicle, I'm never quite sure what that power was, but I was assured it was awesome. The challenge for internet governance as understood in the technical sense is going to be for ICANN and that multi-stakeholder community to really deliver on the ability to keep that operation running without inviting accidentally or unnecessarily a host of non-technical issues that will inspire sovereigns to say, you know what, we do need to get back in there because they're making decisions that go to our sovereignty. So it's going to be fulfill the mission in its narrow technical space with a focus on accountability and making sure that ICANN performs, first and foremost, the IANA functions, and does not invite in these broader sovereign policy discussions that don't belong in the technical environment.
Thank you, John. And it's worth noting that changes in ICANN over the past 2 years have focused on maintaining the narrowness of the ICANN mandate. So I think that'll help in accomplishing what you've suggested. Andrea Glorioso.
Thank you, George. And thanks to the organizer of State of the Net for having me here. For the third year in a row, in fact, so I must have done something right the previous 2 years. So George asked a number of very complicated questions, which I already told him I'm unable to answer in their entirety, so I will limit myself to something that us bureaucrats are very good at, so I'm going to identify the problem but not provide the solution. And from our perspective, from my perspective, the one thing that certainly the European Commission, which is the EU institution that I work for here in Washington, the main issue that we need to pay a lot of attention to is the issue of fragmentation of the internet, as previous speakers have already mentioned. But perhaps from a slightly different perspective than what other speakers and others in these global discussions have raised already. By the way, you will not hear me use the term Balkanization of the internet. That's something that in European circles is a big no-no. We don't use the term for, I must say, rather serious reasons. It's considered to be bad practice to use the term in Brussels, so I will use the term fragmentation. But this kind of joke about terminology already signals that, from our perspective, there is an issue from the very start that we need to understand what fragmentation actually means. I think we can have, and we do have, a relatively good understanding of what fragmentation of the internet means from a technological, from a technical point of view. The inability to reach any IP address, whether it's IPv4, IPv6, from any other IP address, even though in practice we know very well that at any given point of time, the global internet as a network of networks does not always guarantee full reachability. But without entering into the technical details, I think that there is a general consensus on what that means. But the problem is that as we move towards what the internet is actually used for, which at the end of the day is human activities, and those human activities diverge across the world, then whether those human activities actually take place, the limits to those human activities, I'm being willingly very abstract, because the problems that we face from our perspective are not related specifically to trade issues or to cybersecurity issues or to any other issue. They are general and they pertain to the fact that human beings for a very long time have taken different decisions on how their communities would, their own communities would organize themselves in deciding what is acceptable or not acceptable in their endeavors. And I think we need to respect that. I think it would be very unwise to believe that there is a universal notion of, for example, what is the proper level of consumer safety. And if you look at what is the acceptable level of consumer safety in Europe, it is not very, but slightly different than consumer safety in the US. And that has implications on the way that we develop and define internet policies. Just to make an example, which I was personally, professionally involved into in the whole debate about the new generic top-level domains within ICANN. At the time, I was representing the EU in the Governmental Advisory Committee, so I had the opportunity to exchange a lot of very interesting conversation with the ICANN board and other constituencies within ICANN. And I can remember an example, which was the introduction of the new GTLD.pharmacy. And having that kind of GTLD at the top level immediately introduced all kinds of questions. I'm not saying that we had the right answer, but introduced a number of questions in different parts of the world. Who can put themselves, who can put out there in the online environment this sign saying, I am a pharmacy, or sending the signal that I am something similar to a pharmacy. Having said this, I want to be very clear that from our perspective, it's very important that to the extent possible, to the maximum extent possible, and maybe we have not collectively been good enough in that, we need to work more, to the maximum extent possible, we should make sure that the technical unicity of the internet, the universality of the internet, translates also on the policies that we implement for the activities that take place using the internet or on the internet. But I think we also had to be realistic, and we have to be humble, and we have to recognize that we cannot simply go to, or certainly we, speaking for the European Commission, we cannot simply go to the European citizens and tell them, you know, up to this moment, you were accustomed to a certain degree of, to this kind of rules on what you could do in your daily endeavors, on which kind of consumer protection you could expect, or which kind of also freedom of expression or privacy you can expect. And this is not valid anymore because we are going to apply other rules which have been decided somewhere else. I'm not saying, and I want to be clear on this, I'm not saying that our rules are necessarily the best rules. And some in Europe, a number of people in Europe would argue with that, as well as in other countries. But the question for us is, okay, then we need to make sure that whichever way we come up with in order to define what those other rules are, what those new rules are, those ways, those tools that we use to develop those rules are legitimate, which is one of the points that George raised. And I think the issue of legitimacy is something that in the internet governance debate, and I've been following this debate for not as long as some of the people on this panel, but for quite some time, has consistently been swept under the carpet a little bit. It's legitimate because innovation. It's legitimate because the internet. And I can tell you, quite frankly, that that doesn't cut it very well with a number of citizens, certainly not in Europe. Legitimacy comes from a number of elements, of which the practical positive effects of having a global internet is one, because at the end of the day, people vote with their feet. So if you explain to them, if they see that having a global internet and policies that to the extent possible allow activities on the internet to be global, they will accept it as legitimate, but you have to prove it. And I think that's the main risk. The risk is complacency. It's thinking that simply because we had a global internet so far, and simply because, if you allow me speaking personally to be a bit blunt, until now the jurisdictional issues that we have to address have been solved simply because we have been applied the law of the US. Because for the first 10 years of the life of the internet, that was the reality. And we have been a bit complacent in thinking that that would be a sustainable model. And our humble view is that that is not true. And we had to find new ways to address those issues in a more global manner.
Thank you. Next is Derrick Cogburn.
Thank you, George. So George has identified a series of issues and questions for us. And my colleagues have essentially said that there are many things that are important, and we don't necessarily agree on all of the ones that are most important. So there are a number of issues for us to wrestle with. The issue that I wanted to point out, the problem, is around accessibility to the internet for persons with disabilities. And this includes both our current technology, the current standards that we have, and being able to think about the newly emerging technologies as well. So why is this important? In 2011, the World Bank and the World Health Organization issued a global report on disability that struck people to the heart, to the core, that there was more than 1 billion people in the world living with some form of disability. So about 15% of every country's population are people who are living with some form of disability. And so the focus on addressing the needs of those persons is one of the reasons why this is the most important problem, George. I think it's the most important, we think, with the work we're doing. So what happens if this doesn't get addressed? What's the damage that would be done? So clearly there are loss of opportunities in terms of education, employment, entertainment, political participation, for excluding 1 billion people in the world, or 15% of every country's population. So that damage could be significant. It also is excluding those voices, or potentially excluding those voices, from the policy debates and dialogues. So the global disability community has a phrase that emerged out of the negotiations for the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, and that phrase is "nothing about us without us," which means that persons with disabilities should be at the table when issues about them are being debated and discussed, and when policy issues are being developed. And so in our work, we have tried to look at two aspects. How do you enable those voices to participate as partners in this multi-stakeholder dialogue? We know the technical requirements, the knowledge requirements, the travel requirements to be able to participate effectively in these global governance processes. And we've tried to do our part in both using information technology to raise human capacity around those voices, to be able to engage in these types of global governance discussions, but also to be able to focus on the standards in each of those areas. So we've been engaged in a series of accessible global governance projects where we've been using accessible information and communication technologies to engage the global disability community, raise awareness about these issues, and then enable them to participate in the actual conference activities, negotiations, debates, and so forth. So how do we fix this? So I, like others, argue that this problem takes both a technical and a policy solution, but also an economic solution. On the technical side, we need to continue our focus on the standards bodies and encouraging the standards bodies to continue to focus on accessibility issues, as I was saying, not just for the current technologies that we have, but for all of the new and emerging technologies as well. We need to ensure that accessibility gets built into everything that we do. On the economic side, we want to continue to incentivize the private sector, to incentivize businesses to include accessibility as a part of their focus. You know, some of the technologies that we use every day for collaboration and for preparing for our work are not accessible to persons with disabilities, and yet we use them, we go to them as the default mechanism for our collaboration. Google Docs is one example, and it's not accessible to persons who use screen readers. And so we need to continue to incentivize the private sector to focus on these areas. And then the policy solutions. So for us, the policy solutions really stem in some ways from the first human rights treaty of the 21st century, the Convention on the Rights of Persons with Disabilities, which is a comprehensive treaty. It's also an international development treaty. It addresses almost every area of life, and it focuses in Article 9 on accessibility. But it also focuses in Article 8 on awareness raising. And so focusing on the CRPD as a main policy mechanism is one of the things that I would encourage. Now, what's my prognosis? My prognosis is positive. I'm an eternal optimist, but I'm encouraged by what we've seen over the last year with growing numbers of persons with disabilities being organized, using transnational advocacy networks and using information technology to understand better the issues related to a whole range of issues, not just internet governance and the Internet Governance Forum and these areas, but the overlapping conferences as well. So the Sustainable Development Goals that now have 11 mentions of persons with disabilities, Habitat 3 and the New Urban Agenda that was just concluded in Quito that has 15 references to persons with disabilities, even the World Summit on the Information Society plus 10 and the reauthorization of the Internet Governance Forum talks about the critical role for persons with disabilities. So I think that there are a number of signs to indicate that there's a positive future for the active engagement of persons with disabilities in this policy arena.
Thank you, Derrick. Last but not least, Mark Buell.
Thanks, George. And the overflow over here of what I think is mega panel, we're huge. I'm going to take what I think is somewhat of a meta position for this by saying that one of the greatest threats to the internet is, in fact, internet governance. Why not? Somebody has to say it. But by that, I mean to say that the structures and processes that we currently have in place today may need to evolve to ensure that they reflect the internet that we currently have and the internet of the future. In the internet world, we often talk about one of our most important challenges being bringing the next billion online or the last billion, and however you want to frame that. But we need to recognize the fact that many of those people who are coming online now for the first time are from societies that have very different political and philosophical underpinnings than we do in the West. Understandings of fundamental issues like censorship or content blocking may be very different than the values we share, or in fact the hallmarks of the multi-stakeholder model, the fact that a government may have to share the stage with an NGO or the private sector may be very different. So our challenge, I think, is this. How can they be rightfully represented at the table, which, I mean, let's face facts, was predominantly set by interests based in Western Europe and the United States? And even more importantly, how can we do so while ensuring that those characteristics that we believe are so crucial to the success of the internet, the multi-stakeholder model, open dialogue, and the like, are preserved? The current international internet governance debates are all too often dominated by experts from Western Europe and North America. We call them the middle-aged white men. But a truly global, free, and open internet will depend on that changing. Otherwise, I think we risk alienating entire groups of people who will soon make up the majority of internet users in the world. And we would do so at the detriment of the internet. The push on the part of some state actors to shift internet governance from the multi-stakeholder world, which we all know and love, to one that is to a world that's much more multilateral, could only grow stronger if we alienate entire groups of people, leading to fragmentation and a lot of other things that other panelists have spoken about. Do we know how to fix this? I know I don't, but I think it's going to take the internet governance community being more open to engage in more meaningful conversations about how to internationalize the discourse even further. The IANA transition over the past 3 months, 6 months, 2 years, as George said, was a great step. But we're also going to have to look at how we engage in those debates and take what I would think is a much more cooperative approach to these dialogues. And it's going to take a lot of time, but I think it's something we have to do as an internet governance community. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, we've heard six different interpretations of what the problems are with the internet and how they can or might be able to be fixed. The rest is up to you. You know, we now want to engage in vigorous conversation with people in the audience. You can say something independently. You can agree with one of the speakers. You can disagree with the speakers. You can say you left out something that's really, really important. Whatever you want, and let's see how it goes. Jonathan and Steve.
Hey, Jonathan Zook from the Innovators Network Foundation. I have to say that I found Milton's presentation very compelling, so I may need to rethink my priorities. But one of the things that I look at the panel and I see it sort of as the embodiment of what might be the thing that undermines the internet as a whole. And I think that's as distinct from the aspirations of the internet. In other words, a lot of these discussions are about people's afterthoughts about what is the potential of the internet for the advance of humanity, et cetera, not the internet itself, which is a set of wires and networks ultimately paid for and fueled by commerce. So what's missing from the panel and from this discussion is actually what is the incentive structures to continue to innovate, to go from 3G to 5G, et cetera, and all those kinds of things that are actually going to allow the internet to be in the places you want it to be, et cetera. And so if I had to summarize in one sentence the greatest danger to the internet itself, it's undermining the incentive structures that allow the people that are actually the internet to continue to expand and build and creatively engage in the internet space. And it will be because academics, civil society, et cetera, confuse aspirations for the internet, which are amazing and wonderful, from what is in fact fueling and building the internet in the first place.
Okay, thank you, Steve.
In 90 seconds, I'll quickly react. Dr. Mueller, I would give you some relaxation is that the cybercrime aspect of cybersecurity is not likely to be a big threat. The criminals running botnets and distributing malware are making too much money to take the internet down. They're gonna leave it up. And Andrea, I do think you would be better to not conflate labels with conduct. In other words, those who use a label like pharmacy does nothing to restrict your nation's ability to regulate the conduct that occurs under a label. The labels have nothing to do with the conduct underneath it. George, prognosis and disease, I would suggest that the largest threat would be that if the U.S. government were somehow claim or assert by court or by law that it really does own the IANA functions and the root of the internet, and if it were able to exercise that claim through ICANN's presence in California, that would actually be, to me, the worst possible outcome. Now, what's the prognosis of what would happen? I think we'd actually work around it. ICANN would do its best to minimize its subjectiveness to U.S. jurisdiction. It might even move out of the country. But more importantly, the internet service providers and technology companies would route around the problem. We'd end up with a split route, the U.S. route versus the rest of the world route. And, you know, as Andreas said, our browsers and ISPs will find a way around that. I'd still be able to use the internet the way I do today.
Thank you, Steve. Before I go to the next intervenant from the audience, Andreas, Milton, do you want to say anything in response?
Well, one line in response to Steve. Remember what I said. It was not that I feared that cyber criminals themselves would take down the internet. It was that the reaction to cyber security problems, and particularly the linkage between national security and internet governance, would lead to that issue.
That might even lead to what I said was the worst outcome.
Exactly.
First of all, I should have mentioned it, but I and the Commission Committee agrees that ensuring that there are the right incentives, especially for the private sector, to invest at whatever layer of the internet to make sure that innovation continues, the internet expands, is very important. But in order to do that, you also need to ensure that there is legal stability and that everybody knows what the rules are. And also from a pure investment perspective, I would tend to think, at least that's what stakeholders from the private sector tell us, that it's better in order to scale, in order to make sure that your investments can scale, you need to make sure that both at the network level, at the application level, whatever level, your market is as large as possible. And again, to be clear, it is our firm belief that, yes, we should have as much as possible a global internet, because that will allow investments, because if you can sell stuff to 1 billion or 2 billion people as opposed to simply your local market, that's great. That's, by the way, the history of the European Union. That's why we have a common market. So trust me, we understand the value of that very much. It's not even a problem. Our question is, how do we make sure that we get to a place in which we can have sustainable, at the very least coherent or interoperable policies that ultimately will end up regulating the investments or the activities that are produced by the investments on the internet? And if I may, just very quickly on the issue of labels, look, my point is that people have expectations that are linked to labels, and I think that we have plenty of examples from trademark law and from the whole advertising industry that tells us, you know, people would not spend a lot of money into advertising, which means putting a label to an expected activity. And allow me also to say that I don't think people would have invested hundreds of thousands of dollars into a new generic top-level domain unless they expected that the name that that GLD had would have some kind of effect on consumer behavior. And that was our main concern.
Thank you. Next, Venny Markovsky.
Thanks, George. First of all, thanks to both Mark and Andrea for not using the term balkanization. As I come from the Balkans, this is particularly very dear and near to my heart. And unfortunately, Miriam is gone because she used it. maybe that's why she's gone. Secondly, I cover some of the engagement of ICANN with the UN and other intergovernmental organizations in the last couple of years. What I've noticed is that no matter of how good the transition was, and it happened, and everything was fine, there is a parallel discussion that's taking place at these intergovernmental organizations. And oftentimes, it's behind closed doors where we, who are present here, cannot participate because it's governmental only. At these discussions, ideas about public policies, including international public policies, are being exchanged. And on that subject and on that point, and I'll finish with that, there is actually my favorite example from one of the European Union member states. With a 7 million population, they have 2,000 internet service providers. Now, I see people raising their eyebrows here because in New York City, which is 7-8 million people, there are two internet service providers. So there is no choice. The result is that speeds are low, prices are high. It should be the other way around. So this is thanks to a policy which we did with George Sadowsky about 17 years ago in Bulgaria. And we managed to get rid of the regulation and licensing of internet service providers. As a result, is anybody can be an ISP. Jonathan, I think, mentioned that the ISPs will find a way around if there are policies that cause trouble in the route. Well, we found a way around policies that were introduced to limit our activities back then. We sued the government. We also introduced policy. I mean, we also started to put cables wherever we wanted. So I think the internet actually shows that it can find its way. I mean, we always say that the packets go wherever the route is not so busy. This is the same with the physical infrastructure, as long as there is no regulation. So I don't want to limit the conversation only to the US, you know, where there are different issues. But I think around the world, the next billion people will be coming from countries which do not introduce new regulations and new regimes for controlling the flow of information around, you know, the data. So if they let the people offer internet access, it will be around the globe very soon. And Mark will not be arguing, what do we need to do for the next billion people, because they'll be already online.
Thank you, Vinny. Miriam was quite conscious of that gaffe, and she leaned over to me and she said, perhaps we should use United Kingdomization.
I can use that either.
Who's next? Who's next?
Hi, Rick Lane. I see one of the potential biggest issues is burnout of the volunteerism of ICANN and its NGO status. You know, I look at the panel, there are, I think, getting to be more people on the panel than in the audience, where a couple of years ago you had a lot more interest because of the IANA transition and the concerns of the transfer of the IANA function. But I do worry that since it is such a technical entity and stays a technical entity, you know, there's going to be a place where policy is going to be discussed, and where are those policies being discussed now, which is at the ITU. And then there's going to be a blowback into ICANN. But I think to ensure that we have transparency of the ICANN process to keep people interested, we have to figure out how to do that. From a corporate resource standpoint, I know corporations are going to cut back. There's not as much interest in, again, flying around the world. And then you have the poorer countries that don't have the resources to begin with to get to the ICANN meetings. You know, I do worry that as the burnout continues, that we may lose control of sort of the dialogue, discussion, and where things are heading. So that would be one of the areas that I see of concern.
Thanks, Mark. And who's next?
Can I just make one comment on that?
Sure. I think that is such an interesting point. I love the way you started to talk about the burnout, because if you go, as those who go to these meetings around the world, you tend to see the same people at every meeting, whether it's an ITU meeting, an ICANN meeting, an IGF meeting, any of the others, it tends to be the same people that you see over and over and over again. And built into that is something that you just pointed to, is the expense, the cost of everybody, and just moving to all these different places around the world. Four ICANN meetings a year, IGF meetings once a year, all these different meetings, and people flying around to all of these different activities. So finding ways to even enhance more the active participation of the remote participants. I know there've been an enormous amount of effort and resources poured into remote participation. I think we need to continue to do that and to make those voices have even a greater impact on the actual discussions on the ground.
I
have something.
All right, you first.
I think burnout is a factor, and expense is definitely a factor. However, you may not be aware of the fact how ICANN has really maybe done too much to finance people coming to their meetings. And at least in my own neck of the ICANN woods, the non-commercial stakeholders group, the growth in the number of members and the number of activists is incredible. I don't do any NCUC stuff anymore. I pretty much don't care whether I go to ICANN meetings anymore, so you won't see me hanging around all the time. I think that at least in the civil society side, there's great energy and a lot of new people involved. And it is a little bit disturbing to the extent to which ICANN itself funds all of that. I think that we should be self-sustaining, but I don't see the burnout yet. I mean, you see burnout when you're the chair of the NCUC for a year or two, but we get new ones every year.
I think there's also a potential danger. If ICANN views its mission as to be exciting and of the moment, and to be taking up issues that are going to draw a larger audience, there's nothing wrong with being a boring, staid, technical standard-setting body. You know, I'm going to be more meta than Mark and build on something Jonathan said. You know, there's no such thing as the internet. Discuss, right? There is a desire and an ability of disparate network operators to interconnect and communicate with one another. And ICANN creates basic technical rules for that that enable that. And if that's what it does, there'll be fewer people. The people who are involved are going to be impactful on the consistent evolution and innovation in those standards. But the sexier conversations can move to other places. I think the multi-stakeholder model is one that has demonstrated its ability to serve as a very effective clearinghouse for disparate groups from the government and private sector and other places to coordinate and collaborate views. I hate that civil society term. I'll explain why it's some other time. It creates a distinction between that the government's job is to represent something other than the people that they represent. So there's government, non-government, but that civil society thing will be a different discussion. There's more than two internet service providers in New York. And I'll stop there.
Okay, Andrea? I think you have the last word. It's 4:25.
Fantastic.
On the point raised by Rick, first of all, I would respectfully question whether in the past 5 years we haven't had a lot of volunteers around internet discussion, because I can say that in my own experience, back when I was following ICANN at the AGF, at the ATU, wherever you go, I almost only met people who were paid and were professionally doing what they were doing, and whether they were paid through grants, or whether they were paid by university, or whether they were paid by the business, or in my case, by government. That was our job. So the volunteers problem, if anything, is maybe we have too many professionals who, and I speak for myself, at a certain point, you also develop a tendency to, you know, let's keep the group close and cozy, because I found a nice way to travel around the world and to go to all these fancy locations. We wouldn't want to rock the boat too much by including all these people who don't understand what the real issues are. And this leads to my second point, which is related to what you mentioned, what other speakers have mentioned, that at the end of the day, you also had to be able, in order to ensure that we enlarge the conversation, which is relevant for everybody, but you need to be able, we collectively need to be able to explain what is the impact of this discussion, what is the relevance. I think that we have not always, we have come a long way, and that I will certainly agree, but we have also a lot of things that we can do better, and this ultimately links to the point that I made at the beginning, which is about legitimacy. If you don't explain to whomever your constituency is, whether you want to see that constituency as your citizens or your shareholders or your activists, whichever way you want to see that, but you need to be able to explain, look, the way in which we conduct the discussion and the decisions that we take are legitimate for this and this and this reason. And I'm afraid that when it comes to the multi-stakeholder model, again, it's probably better than other models, but we can be way more inclusive than we have been so far.
Thank you very much. It's pretty clear that not everything has been said and not everybody has said anything. So I think we should book the room for next year. Would you make sure of that? All right. Please join me in thanking the panel and the intervenants.
Sure. Thanks for your...